Honourable Member for Timberlea-Prospect.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise just to say a few words on this bill, and I'm not sure if I can be quite as concise and on point as the last two speakers, but I'll try my best. So I'd just like to provide, some juxtaposition with my time that I'm going to speak here, comparing some of the positions that the opposition parties, the members opposite, I guess the members adjacent to me tonight. But I do believe that the issue with power overall on a macro level in the province has to do with the lack of scale we have in our market, and also the lack of diversification, which has been spoken about a little bit. And for decades, we all know that we've relied on fossil fuels, first oil and then coal over the last number of decades. So transitioning to renewables is something that I think that we can all agree to. It's just the amount of how fast you do that and what's affordable to ratepayers and taxpayers. So this plan is definitely more about balance and accountability and predictability over the next 25 years, and I want to commend the minister for bringing this type of plan forward. It's based on 1,300 submissions and consultation with the people. So when you're against this plan, you're against what basically came out of these consultations. When the members speak against what these people consulted, you know, I hear a lot in the House in law amendments and in question period, you know, you have to get out and consult more. But what happens when you don't like when the people have what they have to say? When we consulted, we're putting into action what people are actually asking for. So I think that's important. And you know, I certainly consult as much as I can on all the issues. I've held numerous town halls on lots of topics, and I think it's important that we actually listen to what the people are asking for around the province. So the former NDP government, they started the ComFit program, and that was an aggressive program that looked to renewable energies. And just a couple comments on what I saw, some of the drawbacks to the way that program was implemented. I know that there was a strong focus on wind. And again, going back to my point about diversification, I think that it's important that when you're doing things that you have to have a good mix in the market. And when you focus entirely on wind, you know, I've read a lot of reports that we're getting to kind of the precipice of where we can take advantage of wind power. So particularly going into the winter months, when we can't take advantage of that as much, there's a fast switch into utilization of coal. And when you do that, that spark up of emissions is actually hurting. If we had a better mix, if we had some natural gas in the mix, if we had solar, you wouldn't see that big jump in emissions during that period. When I spent time in Ottawa for a commercial development company, I know that the Ontario feed-in tariff program had a big component for solar energy. And the company that I was director of operations for, we invested heavily in solar energy on the rooftops. And I was really surprised that Nova Scotia didn't include solar as part of their ComFit, because after Ontario, the capacity is there. Nova Scotia actually has the second most capacity for solar energy after Ontario in the whole country. So I think if we had a better mix, we would have been able to utilize sources at different periods of time. You know, it's not always windy, it's not always sunny, but we can have a good mix. So that was one issue with the ComFit. The other issue was this definition of community, which was never defined in a way that people thought that they could contribute. What does community mean? Does it mean a street that the windmills are going up on, or does it mean the subdivision, does it mean the whole municipality? And there was a lot of consternation in some of the communities, including a community close to where I represent. And I think that, you know, a plan is great to have, but it's all about the planning. I think it was Eisenhower that said that. And so that's why this act is good, because even embedded in the act, it's the Electricity Plan Implementation Act. So you have the details of how it's going to be implemented over a 25-year span. So those details are important. And I like the fact that title stays within the scope of what we're trying to achieve. And I know the member for Clare Digby spoke about the points of why that's important for our province, particularly the rural areas. We can take advantage of manufacturing exports. There's a lot of things that we can exploit. And so if we're trying to invest in renewables, why not invest in something that would be perceived and what we can use as a comparative advantage in the future. So it's very expensive now, we know that, but if we're going to invest some money from, you know, the taxpayers, I think it should be targeted at those areas where we know we can maximize benefits for Nova Scotia in terms relative to the other provinces and what their comparative advantages are. And in terms of scale, I know we're going towards looking at a maritime kind of grid so we can share, and that's I think is important too. So that's going to be good to talk about. So now the official opposition, so what their plan was from their platform was an arbitrary five-year freeze. Now that's not even a new plan. That's not a new plan to their party. I could recall in the early 80s. Hard to believe that I can recall. But we know that it was the Buchanan government. The Buchanan government froze power rates. And that subsidized cost embedded into the historic debt, and it's still in the debt. And after, you know, this is the plan that they want to do again. So you freeze rates, that's just going to prolong, that's going to prolong the inevitable. So everybody talks about the selling off of Nova Scotia Power, which was a big deal. They sold Nova Scotia Power,
shame.
But
they
what people
shame.
Need to understand what led to that. Why did they sell Nova Scotia Power? It's because they froze rates arbitrarily, and they had to do something with the massive debt that was built up over that time. You know, from 1978, I think it was the $1.7 billion of debt. When they left government, it was over $8 billion, you know. So you think about after... Confederation, 100 years after Confederation, we were sitting at $1.5 billion of debt. And after a decade past that, it went to $8 billion. Just think about that. So, and I've always believed in the concept of user pay, and that's what we're trying to achieve here. We're trying to achieve the balance of investing in renewable energies with a plan that will provide ratepayers with an ability to pay for something that's within their means. Now, I know there was a lot of talk of the end of the monopoly, and there's some disagreement whether or not that occurred, but you can't argue with the fact that 25% of electricity now does not come from Nova Scotia Power, and that's going to continue to increase. So by definition, if you have one quarter of the power not going through Nova Scotia Power, that's not a monopoly, whether you like it or not. It's not a quick short-term solution, and if it was, somebody else would have done it, but it is a long-term solution because you know that renewable energy prices will go down. As more R&D goes into them, the price of solar, the price of wind will go down. So why give Nova Scotia the ultimate authority to use that through their transmission grids? What we're doing is we're allowing sole proprietors, communities, municipalities to use that. So 10, 20 years down the road, you'll see a decrease in green energy costs. So I think that's smart. I think it's prudent. I think that this plan provides balance that the people are asking for. And, you know, the $1 million that was spoken about, you know, I think if the opposition saw $10 million, $100 million, they'd be saying the same thing right now. Not enough. But I won't take too much more time. But I would say, in the final analysis, let's let the ratepayers and the taxpayers decide after our 4 years. When you see power rates controlled, probably increase less than 5%. Juxtapose that with the prior government that let it go up 30% over 4 years. Let's let the people see what plan that they like. Thank you.